நேர்மணி
Six, seven attendees. Number is increasing.
I'll give a few more minutes for people to join, settle in. Sir, it's on YouTube also, right, sir? Just waiting for people to join in.
Dr. Vijay, you are the host now.
Okay, sir. You can still see the number is increasing slowly, so we allow people to join in. It's 3 more minutes, I think, we'll then start. We're waiting for people to join in, so we are allowing them to settle down. There's already a question. Sameer Bose, what about weight gain in psychiatrists? Googly, it's a googly. Mahesh, it's a googly. Okay, 1 more minute and we'll start. Is also being telecasted in YouTube also live. So we expect some more participants there. Yeah, we'll make a start. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this today's session on Telearogya webinar series. And today's session is on weight gain in psychiatry. We have two eminent speakers, very experienced, and also we have a experienced moderator, Dr. Arvind. I'll just introduce Dr. Arvind in a minute. Before that, I'll give you ground rules. I can see people are still joining in. So unfortunately, for people who are participating, not able to come and speak and participate, but they are able to type questions. So if they can type their questions in Q&A box at the bottom of the screen, next to the question, please put your name and place where you're coming from so we can identify you. We are grateful that you're participating. And also there's a chat box, which you can use it continuously. You can go on, doing any chatting or anything you want to comment. Please go ahead and do as much as chatting you want. Don't get bored. You can also send a lot of messages also to the panelists. So no issues. Please, you're welcome to use the chat box to comment. So the questions can be asked in the Q&A. So the usual format is roughly about for 20 minutes. First speaker, Dr. Samir, will be speaking, and then followed by Dr. Vikas Menon for another 20-25 minutes. After that, we take up questions from Q&A section, and then we have our moderator who will continue this interactive session. So don't forget questions in the Q&A box. Let me introduce the moderator today before I hand over the session to the moderator. It's Dr. Arvind ST, and he has done his MBBS from Mysore University, DPM from Father Muller, and then he spent some time in UK, roughly about 15 years of experience with 5 years in NHS in UK. He was a topper in the CASC exam, MRCP exams, and he worked in treatment-resistant schizophrenia unit in West London. Mental Health Trust is a famous researcher there in London. He also worked in Rampton, the high secure forensic unit. And also he has done several psychiatry awareness scientific talks at TV, Akashwani, Visheshwaraya Technical University, Coimbatore University. And he's also an active member of IMA, IPSKC. He was also a EC member of IPSKC in the past. He's written articles in newspaper. He's a founder of Positive Mind Training Institute. He's a motivational speaker. And he's also winner of Kanaka Shri Chetana Award. He was honored by DC and Home Guards Commandment for free mental camps and psychological training of underprivileged in rural Shimoga. He's been very active, dynamic. So another name for dynamic psychiatry in the central Karnataka is Dr. Arvind. So with this small introduction, I'll hand over the session to Dr. Arvind. Please, can you take over the session? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Vijay, for that wonderful introduction of mine. I would like to give a warm welcome to all the coordinators of Telearogya webinar, the August audience, and the eminent speakers. Today, I just wanted to introduce the speaker and move on with today's topic. The today's topic is, as you all know, it's weight gain in psychiatry. It's a very common clinical challenge as we see our psychiatry patients putting on weight over a period of time. And weight gain is a public health problem due to its non-compliance, can lead to non-compliance of psychiatric treatment and added psychological and physiological burden. So is it just medications like olanzapine or clozapine, which is known to increase an average increase of weight from 1.7 to 2.3 kg per month, according to Wettering et al.? Or is it just the disease, chronic nature of their disease, or lifestyle changes or metabolic changes? Or is it just individual susceptibility which causes this weight gain in our field of psychiatry? So we have an eminent speaker, Dr. Samir Kumar Praharaj. So I'd like to introduce Mr. Dr. Samir Kumar Praharaj to all of you so that you would be addressing all the issues I raised. So Dr. Samir Kumar Praharaj has done MBBS from Guwahati Medical College and did his DPM and MD from Central Institute of Psychiatry, Ranchi. He's a faculty of KMC, Kasturba Medical College, Manipal, since 2019. And he's currently the professor and head of the Department of Psychiatry in the same medical college. He's a GSM Primer Fellow in 2017. His areas of interest being psychopharmacology, brain stimulation, and medical education. He has publications in peer-reviewed journals, book chapters. He's the chief associate editor of IJPM. And he's a recipient of several awards. To quote few, he was given the Best Resident Award in 2007, Samuel Gerson Young Investigator Award in 2008. He has several travel awards, And lastly, he has got Professor Raghuram Distinguished Young Teacher Award in 2016. Now over to Dr. Sameer.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Arvind, for that introduction. At the outset, I want to thank Dr. Mahesh Gowda and team for giving me this opportunity. Okay, so before we start the topic, just want to bring in few points. So some common questions that you must have encountered in your day-to-day practice. Patients coming and asking, let's say, can I stop medications now? It's enough. I've been taking this for quite some time. I'm already doing yoga. Is there any need for taking medications? How long do I have to take medications? Will they affect my kidneys, my liver? So these are common concerns we hear day-to-day practice, isn't it? And so on. Another thing that we also commonly hear is, doctor, I'm getting better, but I'm getting fatter. So with this, we'll come to the topic for today's discussion, weight gain. So these are the few things that I will cover today in this 20 minutes. So what exactly is weight gain? Why should we be bothered about this? Is it a problem? We know that drugs actually contribute. Is it only medications or there are other things also? And what are the possible reasons why people develop this? So we'll just run through this. So it is a very brief presentation. So I'll just run through the points, but then we'll take up questions and we'll discuss. Okay, now that we are in pandemic times, so we all know about COVID-19 pandemic. There is another pandemic that is happening. So what I would say is a webinar pandemic. I think right now there will be many parallel webinars that will be happening. So I don't know. I mean, people have to choose between webinars, and then I guess I think people will be fed up with webinars within a short period of time. And like that, many other pandemic happening. So another pandemic which is there is obesity pandemic. So this is something we should be aware about, and that is what will be the focus for today's discussion. So weight gain, it's easy to identify. You just monitor the body weight, see whether it's changing over time. But body weight only is not enough. There are other things which are important. The other thing that we usually document is BMI, body mass index. We all are familiar with that. I'll come to the pros and cons little bit, which one to measure and why. The other thing that is recommended is measuring waist circumference. So at, let's say, umbilical level, so that is something which is more useful than BMI. Some consider it is much more useful, because BMI actually may not pick up all people who have obesity. The other thing that is recommended is waist ratio. So anything which is, and it's also almost similar to waist circumference. So either you measure waist circumference or waist hip ratio, both are almost similar, although there is some difference. And something which is coming up nowadays is abdominal fat measurement. So I'll come to that again. So if you see the definition of obesity, what is obesity? Basically, fat accumulation, which is in excess quantity in the body, and which actually leads to some clear health risk. So that is important. So now body fat accumulation, how do you find out? So body weight is one indicator, but like I said, BMI, waist circumference, other things are also quite important. So if you see the relationship between BMI and body fat, so actually BMI sometimes in some proportion of patients may underestimate obesity. So that is one reason you should also be documenting the other parameters, like let's say waist circumference. So you have all these definitions based on BMI, based on waist circumference. Who is obese, who is overweight, who is underweight. So one thing that I want to highlight is the definitions are actually quite different for Asians. So if you see, like obesity, so the usual one that is recommended all over the world is 30, but then for Asians it is 27.5. should be aware about this particular fact. Same goes for, let's say, waist circumference. If you see, 40 inches is something which is there for, let's say, a general definition, but then in Asians, actually, even more than 35 inches is also important. So these are some things that you need to keep in mind when you are measuring. The other concept that has come up is something called visceral obesity. So at least a subgroup of patients, it is more to do with the visceral fat, the abdominal fat, which is inside intra-abdominal, not on the muscular wall, not beneath the skin. So it is very difficult to measure. The only way to do that is do a CT scan, or there are other ways, and it can be quantified. Obviously, it is not practical in clinical practice, mainly for research, but just be aware about this fact. Now, what are the consequences? I think all of us know about the consequences. I don't want to go into the different disorders. So ranging from cardiovascular, diabetes, many types of cancers, orthopedic conditions, GI conditions, including in cataract, depression. So all these could be consequences of, let's say, obesity. So what are the risk factors? So genetics, it has been found like around 40% to even some say up to around 80% contributes to obesity. Yes, it is not only genetics, but then environmental factors, specifically unhealthy diet, high fat diet, sugar laden diet. So these are some things which can be risk factors. Inactive lifestyle. Basically, what we talk about is the built environment or obesogenic environment, which leads to obesity along with genetic factors. So other things which are coming up like gut microbiome changes, childhood adversities, any kind of neglect, parental neglect, abuse, separation, those things also can contribute. Socioeconomic factors, we all know about that. Okay. So now, essentially, what causes, so the relationship between different disorders and weight gain, including the causes, I'll come to the drugs and other part also. So we know the relationship between depression and weight gain. So patients with depression can present with, let's say, weight loss. But then again, depression actually can lead to weight gain. I'll come to that. The relationship with atypical depression, bipolar disorder, that also we know. So reverse vegetative signs. Chronic schizophrenia can also lead to a lot of eating, which can lead to weight gain. So it's more of indiscriminate kind of eating in some patients. Eating disorders, of course, there is a relationship. I'll not go into much into that. Some particular form of personality types, specifically cluster B, specifically borderline personality, there is another association with weight gain. So weight loss, weight gain, that cycle, that also is related. Many sleep disorders that are associated with weight gain, I'll just examine a little bit. Substance abuse, and of course, drugs. Okay, now what are the drugs which cause weight gain? So we all know about antipsychotics. I think antipsychotics, antidepressants, mood stabilizers, I'll come to that in a minute. But we ascribe most of the weight gain in our mental health, our psychiatric patients to all these three class of medications. But is it only psychotropic medications? If you see, most of the anti-diabetic medications, except maybe for metformin, which actually causes weight loss, all other anti-diabetic medications, including insulin, sulfonylurea, all causes weight gain, lot of weight gain. And many of our patients actually have diabetes, they're on anti-diabetic medications. We don't discuss about that. We'll always blame antipsychotics. Antihypertensives, beta blockers, and others also, more to do with beta blockers, which actually cause weight gain. Again, many of our patients are on these medications. Steroids. Glucocorticoids. Some patients would be receiving these medications. So we need to be aware that even in psychiatric patients, so it is not just antipsychotics, antidepressants, or mood stabilizers which cause weight gain. Rather, other medications which are commonly used can also contribute to weight gain. Now, another question that we ask is like, okay, typical antipsychotics are quite safe, atypical antipsychotics are bad in that way because they can cause weight gain. So is it only atypical antipsychotics which are to be blamed? So this particular meta-analysis says otherwise. So it says that all antipsychotics, virtually all antipsychotics given let's say prolonged exposure to these medications can cause weight gain. And this is specifically important in patients who are drug naive. So antipsychotic naive, they are the ones who are likely to have more weight gain, and specifically young children, adolescents. And we know that schizophrenia and bipolar disorder origins and starts in adolescent period. And these are times when they're put on medications, they lead to a lot of weight gain. Now, if you compare the weight gain risk of antipsychotics, if you see olanzapine, clozapine, these are higher risk. And if you see, there are some medications which have low risk. But you should also note that several typical antipsychotics also can cause weight gain, specifically thyridine and clofazimine. The mechanism is quite complex. I'll not go into specific details, but just to give an idea, many different systems. It is not just histamine or one particular system. Many different neurotransmitters are implicated. Now, there is another argument which comes up, like whether weight gain is actually necessary for any therapeutic effect. So there are many views, as you can see here. So whether the weight gain per se can lead to therapeutic benefit, or is it the therapeutic benefit which weight gain is just a byproduct, side effect, or both are happening separately, different mechanisms are there. So that is also true for some medications. So probably all these are true to some extent. So depending on the type of patient, depending on the type of medications. So again, to remind ourselves that schizophrenia is not a single condition. It's a many different types of schizophrenia. So some patients, some particular mechanism can work. So there is another concept that has been propounded, something similar to what we know about neuroleptic threshold for typical antipsychotics. And I think our group from NIMHANS, Dr. Venkat, who has written a nice paper, done a study also, propounded about this metabolic threshold. Essentially, those who respond, they also have metabolic side effects, including weight gain. So, so response is related to the side effects. So that is one hypothesis. May not be true for all patients. So that is something that we need to remember. Okay, so not only antipsychotics, antidepressants have also been shown to lead to weight gain. And if you see, the risk is almost more than 21%. So increased risk. So more the number of years of antidepressant use, higher the rates of weight gain. And if you see, among antidepressants, specific medications like, let's say, tricyclics, specifically amitriptyline, among SSRIs, paroxetine, mirtazapine, these are the ones which are to be blamed the most. Again, it has been seen that the major mechanism is H1 receptor affinity. So most of the antidepressants, so weight gain is through this mechanism. But this is not the only one. So if you see, there are many other mechanisms, including serotonergic, adrenergic, many other mechanisms which can actually lead to weight gain. So again, I'll not go into details about this. Other medications like, let's say, lithium, a very commonly used mood stabilizer, that also causes weight gain. And the only thing is there are very few studies that have actually examined, looked into this one in a proper way. But yes, one study which has seen, they found that obese patients are actually likely to gain more weight with lithium as compared to non-obese patients. Anti-epileptic medications, again, used as mood stabilizers. If you see the common ones that we use, like valproate, carbamazepine, these are the ones which are likely to cause a lot of weight gain. And the other medications which are actually weight neutral, like topiramate, are not good anti, let's say, mood stabilizers that way, not very effective medications. So this is just a snapshot, a summary of all the medications. If you see, the medications which are notorious to cause weight gain are, let's say, amitriptyline, mirtazapine, clofazimine, clozapine, olanzapine. So these are the ones, and valproate. So these are the ones, lithium also. These are the ones which can cause a lot of weight gain. Okay, so, and this is basically a diagrammatic representation of, again, like if you see on the right-hand side, medications which cause a lot of weight gain, left-hand side, medications which cause very less of weight gain, or maybe a little bit of weight loss also. But one thing that I want to tell about this weight neutral drugs, so we can name antipsychotics like aripiprazole, ziprasidone, amisulpiride, lurasidone, antidepressants like fluoxetine, bupropion, topiramate, zonisamide. these are weight neutral drugs, but are they truly weight neutral? So that is another question that we need to understand. Like I said, many patients on prolonged exposure to these medications also can, it can result in weight gain. So mechanisms again can be different. So actually these are relatively weight neutral, you can say. And if you see another way to classify, there are very few medications which actually cause weight loss. So one is bupropion, one is topiramate, zonisamide. Barring these three drugs, all other medications, even including clozetin, which can cause weight gain over a period of time. The other question that I want to raise is, all weight gain, is it real? So, I mean, basically I want to draw your attention to subjective versus objective weight gain. So it is known that self-reported weight gain is not reliable. And this is much more important in patients with schizophrenia. Underreporting is quite common. And I'll, another thing, another fact is, in normal population also, those who are obese, they will never admit that they're obese. So so it is something which is basically reflecting the general trend in the population. Okay, little bit about the different illnesses and weight gain. So depression, like I said, depression can cause weight gain, and also weight gain can cause depression. It's a cycle which you see. So many reasons are there. So one hypothesis is inflammatory pathway. Atypical features, if like those who have depression with atypical features, which is much more common in women, again points towards more of bipolarity. So these are some things that we need to keep in mind when we discuss about weight and depression. In eating disorders, bulimia, you can see something what we call the binge purge cycle as compared to the healthy eating cycle. So they eat more, then they binge, they purge, then again they diet, and then again once they start hunger, there'll be again a binge episode. So that cycle continues. So what about drugs of abuse? Let's say nicotine. Nicotine actually suppresses appetite, and when someone is coming out of nicotine, let's say leaving nicotine, that time they gain weight. Alcohol, long run, can lead to weight gain. Cannabis use, again, there's a lot. It's basically sort of leads to hyperphagia when a person takes cannabis. Cocaine and stimulants. So these are some medications which actually reduce appetite. So appetite suppressants. Same goes for hallucinogens. Actually, most of the hallucinogens and stimulants, they came from the drugs which were being experimented as anorexigenic drugs. Okay, so the weight gain in smokers, this is one reason why many smokers actually refuse to quit cigarettes, giving a reason that, okay, I'll gain weight once I quit smoking. So, and it's true also, like more than 13% actually gain more than 10 kgs of weight. So this is quite significant. But then you should also remember that there's a certain proportion who actually lose weight also after quitting smoking. So just wanted to highlight this aspect. The relationship between sleep and obesity. So short sleep duration has been specifically associated with obesity. So this is a meta-analysis. So we know that sleep apnea is something which is another condition which is associated with obesity. There are many different mechanisms. I'll not go into the exact mechanism, how sleep deprivation leads to obesity, but there's a lot of literature on that. So do all get fat? So we'll discuss about genes. So is it all about genes? Yes, to some extent, like I said, around 40%, 50%, it is genes. And let's say the relationship between the weight gain and the psychiatric disorders. So you can talk about common pathophysiology also in certain conditions. So probably that is one reason, one mechanism for weight gain. Yes, knowing about the pharmacogenetic effects of these medications will be helpful, because then we can actually predict people whether someone will gain weight with particular medication. And there are some studies which have been done, and we have actually found serotonin receptors which have been associated with antipsychotics related weight gain. This particular receptor has very robust effect. Moderate evidence for many other receptors. So I'll not go into the particular receptor, particular genes, but then, yeah, we, these are, this for this we have good evidence. and less consistent the other receptors. One thing that I wanted to highlight is the two genes which have been highlighted in red. So these are the actually obesity-related genes in general population, not related to antipsychotics per se, but in general population. So there is an overlap, if you see. It's the same genes which are there related to obesity are actually being affected with antipsychotics. So again, common pathophysiology. A little bit about why obesity happens. So you can talk in terms of, let's say foodstuff, unhealthy lifestyle. And you can talk in terms of let's say a simple equation in which energy intake and energy expenditure. So if energy expenditure is more, then the weight will be less. If calorie intake is more, then the weight will increase. And there is a homeostatic set point, something like your, let's say, temperature regulator, no, in hypothalamus. So something like that also is there in hypothalamus, which basically controls the body weight within a certain limit. So this is a very simple equation, but is it that simple? So let's see whether any specific dietary component actually increases the risk. So we know from studies, this is basically based on a consensus that I am quoting. So saturated fats, we know that can lead to a little bit more obesity as compared to polyunsaturated fatty acids, although it is not something which is proven. Macronutrients, like whether you are fat predominant diet or carbohydrate predominant diet. So both have their pros and cons. So again, not very clear. So some say that fat laden diet can lead to weight gain. Some say even carbohydrate laden diet also can lead to weight gain. So food contents, what kind of food? So whether you're taking more of meat, more of dairy product, so those are taking meat, high chances. Again, those are taking red meat versus processed meat. The processed meat actually, there are higher chances for weight gain. Similarly, sugars, specific sugars, simple sugars like sucrose and fructose, if it is more in the diet, that can lead to weight gain as compared to complex sugars. So these are some of the consensus that has come up. But I want to highlight one more thing. There is another aspect to the let's say obesity. So when we talk about, let's say, high fat diet, so highly palatable food, so what we call hyper palatable food, that can actually, so I'll tell you different types of obesity again. So what we call basically emotional eating. So sometimes, so stress can lead to this kind of emotional eating. And this is specifically seen in particular personality types, let's say those who have borderline types, some particular types of eating disorders. So many different conditions, so psychiatric conditions, which can have this particular phenomenon of emotional eating. So this is another thing, another concept which is coming up. And we are, based on this, we are actually trying to classify again obesity into many different types. So just to highlight, you can classify them into two types of obesity. One is a metabolic obesity, one is a hedonic kind of obesity. In metabolic obesity, which is common, the most common variety. So like I said, there is a set point, body weight, which is controlled by hypothalamus, and body tries to balance. So the energy, how much you are consuming, how much you are spending. So there's a balance which is strike. But then again, it can be affected because of other external factors, such as, let's say, someone is receiving medications or for some other reason. So which can lead to change in the set point. So the set point that is there actually moves to a different level. So there's a new set point. And this is the mechanism behind the common type of obesity, what we call metabolic obesity. But the new type of obesity that we are seeing now is something, like I said, I was discussing about emotional eating. So here, it is more the food actually, which is a hedonic signal. So essentially, it is almost akin to drugs. So so the fat laden fruit, the food, and which can lead to weight gain, is something akin to, let's say, any kind of drug. And it uses the same reward pathway. So basically, there'll be weight gain through the involvement of this particular reward pathway, involvement of dopamine, increase in dopamine nucleus accumbens, which can actually lead to this hedonic kind of obesity. So that is something which we can even call something like a food addiction. Yes, it is not something which is common, but I think we need to look into this particular phenomenon a little bit more closely. So based on this, we can say there are two basic type of obesity. Okay, but like I said, so this whole balance was not something which is very simple. So now we saw there are many different factors which can actually lead to obesity. So this is just a summary slide of all different causes which can lead to, let's say, overeating, less of energy expenditure, and physical inactivity, which includes even let's say psychiatric disorders, use of medications. So all those things will come. So to let's say summarize, so just this is the last slide, just to summarize. So weight gain is common, specifically with psychotropic medications, but like I said, don't forget about non-psychotropic medications, like anti-diabetic medications, antihypertensive medications, steroids, those medications. There are several disorders which say are common risk. So that is another thing that we need to understand. And it's not just genetics. So without environmental risk factors, actually there would be vulnerability, but not everyone will develop obesity. So environmental risk factors are essential. Also, we need to understand there are multiple types of obesity. So it's not just a single type. So the mechanisms will be very different. So risk assessment is something that we need to do. In the next presentation, Dr. Vikas will be talking more about how to assess, how to treat. But then just remember how to assess and what all things to keep in mind, specifically focusing on simple things like, let's say, waist circumference. We would be measuring just body weight, but we'll forget to measure the waist circumference. Simple things which can be done in a clinical practice. Periodic monitoring is important because many patients don't spontaneously report. So you'll have to objectively actually check in patients. Timely intervention is important because prevention is important because treatment is actually very difficult. What again, Dr. Vikas will be discussing. Treatment of weight gain is very difficult. So if you can prevent, that's the best strategy. So I'll stop here. So this is just last slide. So Manipal. So yeah. So thank you. I request Dr. Arvind to take over.
Thank you, Dr. Samir Kumar. It was an excellent, crisp presentation of an elaborative topic, I would say. So you have covered most of the things, what are the causes for obesity in psychiatry, the different types of obesity, and how the obesity is measured, as well as the consequences of being obese in a psychiatric patients. So thanks for that wonderful presentation. Moving on, I think the next speaker is Dr. Vikas Menon. He would probably focus more on the assessment part of the obesity, predictors for weight gain, as well as intervention. That would be in terms of both pharmacological as well as non-pharmacological intervention, behavioral modification, as well as lifestyle changes. So to introduce Dr. Vikas Menon, Dr. Vikas Menon is an additional professor of psychiatry at Jawaharlal Institute of Postgraduate Medical Education, that is JIPMER, Puducherry. He has completed his postgraduation training in 2008 from JIPMER and has 15 years of psychiatry experience. His research work focuses on digital psychiatry, suicidology, and mood disorders. He has contributed over 150 scientific publication in various referred journals, two book chapters, and his work has won several prestigious research excellence awards. He is the deputy editor of Indian Journal of Psychiatry and the chief associate editor of Indian Journal of Psychological Medicine. So I will welcome Dr. Vikas Menon. Over to Dr. Vikas Menon now.
Good evening. Thank you, respected chairperson, for the very kind introduction, and a big hi to all the participants who have made it, even though it's quite late on Saturday. I hope my screen is visible. Yeah. So, yeah, after that excellent overview by Dr. Sameer on the various causes of weight gain in psychiatric settings, so I'm going to focus for the next 20-25 minutes on the management part of it. And in this management, I'll be focusing a lot on drug-induced weight gain, but and also just touching upon some other causes of weight gain. So this will be the outline of my presentation over the next 20 minutes. So first, we'll talk about monitoring or assessment frequency for weight and other metabolic parameters in severe mental illness, because as the adage goes, you know, prevention is better than cure. And I think Dr. Sameer also in his conclusion highlighted that prevention is better than cure, because whatever treatment you give, the bottom line is the benefits are quite modest, and typically patients find it difficult to lose all the weight that they have gained, whatever they do or whatever we advise. So if you can prevent it, nothing like it. So that's why the monitoring becomes extremely important. Then we'll move on to some general principles of weight management in severe mental illness, followed by lifestyle interventions before we discuss pharmacologic interventions, because in the hierarchy of interventions, lifestyle interventions is positioned earlier to drug interventions. And then at the end, as I said, we'll just have a couple of slides on management of weight gain due to other causes. So if you see this slide, this table, it gives you the recommended frequency for monitoring. I'll draw your attention to this parameter here, the weight and BMI. So you have to monitor the weight at baseline, followed by 6 weeks and then 3 months. So this is regardless of whether the patients are taking or not taking antipsychotic medications, because all patients with severe mental illness are prone to gain weight, irrespective of whether they're taking drugs or not. So you have to weigh them when you see them at baseline, followed by 6 weeks and 3 months. And then subsequently, every 3 months, you should repeat their weight monitoring. So this is there is an explicit as well as an implicit message from this slide. The explicit message, as you can see here, I hope my cursor is also visible to you. So the explicit message is that in the first year of antipsychotic treatment, the monitoring is more intensive. So you can see that the frequency of monitoring is much more intensive in the first year of antipsychotic treatment. Subsequently, some of the parameters are monitored every 3 months, some are monitored annually. So the monitoring frequency kind of drops. So that's the explicit message. Again, the idea here is to pick up maximum individuals in the first few weeks, because a lot of weight gain happens in the first few weeks of initiating the medications. The more implicit message from this slide is also important. That is that these monitoring guidelines are what they are. They are guidelines, but we have to apply our clinical judgment. For example, if I find that someone's fasting blood glucose is impaired at baseline, then I am going to monitor that individual at a much in more intensive frequency than what is recommended in this table. Similarly for weight, similarly for smoking status, and so on. So you need to also, you know, apply the judgment, apply clinical judgment to find out what frequency of monitoring might suit an individual patient, depending on whether or not they show abnormalities which are out of range in the initial assessments. Coming to general principles of weight management, all patients with severe mental illness, regardless of whether they are taking antipsychotics or not, should receive education about nutrition, weight management. They should receive encouragement to increase physical activity, because sedentary lifestyle is one of the biggest contributors to increased cardiovascular risk in severe mental illness. So if you see the lifespan of people with severe mental illness, they are decreased anywhere between 15 to 25 years compared to the general population. And the biggest contributor to this increased or excess mortality is cardiovascular risk. So you need to encourage all of them to increase physical activity. If you want to select a treatment strategy in patients who have one or more metabolic abnormalities, then you would be guided by these considerations: past history of response to different antipsychotics, the severity of the baseline metabolic disturbance. So for example, if someone is overweight, I would not necessarily like to start, say, for example, olanzapine in such individuals. I will select my treatment strategy a little differently there. And of course, the willingness of the patient to make lifestyle changes. So in a patient who's obese, as well as doesn't seem very motivated to go for lifestyle changes, maybe you would like to stay off some of the you know, antipsychotics with an increased propensity for weight gain, like olanzapine. The management principles of weight gain for severe mental illness is the same whether patients are taking antipsychotics or not. The only difference being that in patients who are on antipsychotics, you might want to consider, you might want to reevaluate your choice and dose of the antipsychotic. So you might want to consider dose reduction in patients where it is feasible. It's not really feasible all the time. But you might want to do that under monitoring because that might reduce their weight gain, subsequent weight gain. And you might want to switch antipsychotics. That's again not possible all the time, especially if patients are on drugs like clozapine. It's really difficult to switch antipsychotics, but you might want to consider that in other situations wherever possible. Now, for overweight patients, overweight is typically defined as BMI between 25 to 29.9. So in such patients, you might, as a first-line treatment, want to consider comprehensive tailored lifestyle intervention or medication, with the choice between these two being largely guided by the intervention's availability as well as the patient's motivation, preferences, and capabilities. In patients who are motivated and who appear capable of implementing, lifestyle intervention should be generally recommended first, proceeding to medications if this is ineffective. Having said that, there is an emerging body of evidence or data, especially on antipsychotic-induced weight gain in the early few weeks in antipsychotic-naive patients, where data support a more aggressive management, that is, introducing medications more early. So if you see Dr. Sameer's presentation, he also talked about how antipsychotic-naive patients are more likely to gain weight in the initial few weeks. So there, you might want to consider a more aggressive management. There is data to support that. But otherwise, lifestyle interventions should be generally recommended first. So is there evidence for lifestyle interventions? Yes, there is. So this was perhaps one of the latest meta-analysis that I was able to pick up. So this was published in late 2019. So this was a meta-analysis of 41 RCTs with more than, cumulatively, more than 4,000 participants. The relative risk for losing more than 5% of baseline body weight. So this is kind of a metabolic threshold. So which if you lose more than 5% of the baseline body weight, then your cardiovascular risk drops significantly. If you lose less than 5% of the body weight, then the drop in cardiovascular risk is not so appreciable. So that should be the goal. When you initiate weight management treatment for SMI patients, you really want them to lose more than 5% of the baseline body weight. So the relative risk for that was 1.51 in favor of the lifestyle interventions. But if you see in terms of clinical relevance, the difference was about 2.5 kilos. So that's not something to really crow about. So that's again why prevention is much more important than trying to treat the weight that is already gained. And of course, there was a lot of, the authors noted a lot of bias, high risk of bias in most of the studies. So there is a lot of scope for future research with subgroups to identify which subgroups may optimally benefit from these lifestyle interventions. But nevertheless, there are certain components of the lifestyle interventions that are advocated for weight gain. So this is the next couple of slides are the major part of my talk. So what are the effective components of lifestyle intervention for weight gain in SMI patients? I'll run through the four components and then I'll have a couple of slides on each of them. So psychoeducation, focusing on the nutritional or caloric value of food. Dietary advice on dietary and physical activity modification, and not either of them, but both of them. Then learning skills of behavioral self-management. And finally, motivation enhancement therapy. So in psychoeducation, you want to actually focus on caloric content of food. So you really want them to, you may really want to advise patients to stay off calorie dense foods like sugar sweetened beverages, alcohol, and packaged or processed foods. Recommended composition of diet. Now, there are excellent apps that help you to customize your diet depending on, you feed in some data like age, gender, and some of your comorbidities, you can get a recommended composition of diet. I am not recommending any apps here because I have not personally tried any of them, but there are many like MyFitnessPal or HealthifyMe, which are free to download. Some of the functionalities are free, some of the functionalities are paid, but many of them go beyond calorie tracking and actually advise you on what foods to avoid and what foods are recommended for a person of your profile. Then information on healthy snack choices, because, you know, let's face it, all of us like to snack. And there is evidence that having one or two small snacks in a day can actually reduce the portion size consumed during regular meal times. And that may perhaps be more relevant, I feel, for Indian patients, because invariably I see most of the Indian patients during their regular meals, that is the heaviest meals are usually the lunch and the dinner, are invariably rice-based or heavy on carbohydrates. That's not really providing a good balance of nutrients. In fact, many of the Indians can be classified as rice eaters. So this website I've personally gone through, I found it very useful. It's actually in sync with the American Heart Association recommendation. So this is something maybe that you can recommend for your patients. It might look Western oriented, but I did find a lot of foods that are applicable to the Indian diet also. So things like healthy snack choices could be nuts, raisins, dates, unsweetened fruits, popcorn. So who knows, who would have imagined that popcorn is a whole grain food. So most of these healthy snack choices are whole grain based, also give you a lot of calories. At the same time, they are quite healthy. So dietary and physical activity modification. So here again, you would ask them to avoid alcohol and sugar sweetened beverages. Plan 3 major meals and 1 to 2 small filler snacks per day. Do 30 minutes of some sort of exercise every day. So the last week's Tele Arogya webinar was on exercise recommendations. I attended that webinar. And I think the main message from that webinar was that it's not important what kind of exercise you do, as long as you do some exercise per day. So simple aerobic exercise. Now, aerobic exercise is anything that increases your heart rate and respiratory rate. So walking, jogging, skipping, running. So all these. So do 30 minutes of some sort of exercise every day. That I think should be a standard recommendation that we give for all our SMI patients. And one inconspicuous way to incorporate exercise into daily activities is something that I recommend to everyone, and I think it's very practical advice, because, for example, if you're parking your car in the parking lot, then park the car farthest from the office so that you get more steps into your legs when you commute to the office door. Similarly, at work, always use staircase rather than elevators. So these are some simple advice that you can give to clients where, you know, they can blend exercise into their daily activities. It doesn't look like a chore anymore. And I think a very practical advice is to ask everyone to find an exercise buddy. So we all need exercise buddies, because like the one in this picture, because then basically we keep motivating each other. Moving on to learning skills of behavioral self-management, because ultimately we want patients to become their own therapists as far as weight management is concerned. So this is a simple acronym for goal setting in behavioral self-management. So you need to be SMART. So what is SMART? S is for specific. So at the outset, you need to ask patients to ask themselves specific questions: who, what, when, why, and how. So what am I going to achieve? How am I going to achieve, and so on. Moving on to measurable. So the patients also need to know how they can measure what they set out to achieve, so that it's kind of a motivation for them when they know how they can measure their goals. Then attainable. So they need to set small goals. So typically I found that if you ask patients to walk 30 minutes, you know, they feel deflated, discouraged. No, it's not possible. I cannot spare 30 minutes, and so on. And I found that Indian patients don't take lightly, you know, to exercise recommendations for different reasons. Maybe we can discuss that later. So I always advise them to start off with 5 minutes or 10 minutes, and then perhaps they could increase on a weekly basis by every 5 or 10 minutes till the target range is achieved. So realistic, so that's a follow-up on the attainable part. So the goals that we are setting must be both willing as well as able to achieve. And then timely, it must be rounded off in a, you know, defined time frame. So some self-management tips for weight gain. So self-monitoring of daily food intake and activity through, you know, whichever phone you're using. There are excellent apps that are available for Samsung users, Samsung Health, iHealth for iPhone users, Google Fit for the non-Samsung Android phone users. They all give calorie tracking as well as step counter and activity tracking. One practical advice is to use a smaller plate for eating, because then you practice, you know, you're implicitly practicing portion control there, and incorporate mindfulness into eating. So the picture there is a strict no-no. That is, you must not eat in front of TV, screen, gadgets, because then we don't know actually how much we are consuming there. And finally, in lifestyle management, lifestyle interventions, motivational enhancement therapy. So here the principles are more or less the same that we do for the substance use disorders, because in both of these conditions, you know, the goal is to promote behavioral change. So first you want to engage the patient, So when we engage the patient, you want to ask them that, you know, can we take a few minutes to discuss your weight? So that's also respecting patient autonomy there. And then we move on to open-ended questions that allow for expression. So Mr. X, how do you feel about your weight? Then move on to affirmative statements to support positive behavior. So what I understand is you already tried a lot of interventions to reduce your weight. So from this, I really get the impression that this is really important for you. So you're actually supporting the positive behaviors there. Followed by reflection to allow the patient to feel heard. So you are going to make reflective statements. So I get the feeling that you want to try and reduce your weight, but you know, you also seem to be having a hard time in planning and cooking your meal. So tell me a little more about it. So like that. And then at the end, move on to summary statements. So what I'm hearing is that you really want to try and you've been struggling with your weight for all these years. And you also have tried a lot of diets that didn't work as you expected. So you seem to be wanting to make a change, but you're not quite sure of what to do next. So these kind of summary statements, what they do is they try to bring out the next steps for change from the patient themselves, which is what we want. You know, we really, really don't want the, in motivational enhancement, you don't want the therapist to be the one telling the next steps for change. You want it to come from the patient. So these kind of summary statements would be pretty useful. So that's it about lifestyle interventions. So moving on to medications, I'm just going to discuss about five medications which have maximum evidence going for them. And two of them are upcoming agents with very promising evidence. So metformin, in the hierarchy of evidence, first right up comes metformin, followed by topiramate, followed by aripiprazole, and then two upcoming agents, liraglutide and samidofan. So in metformin, so there are various meta-analyses on metformin for antipsychotic-induced weight gain. One of them was done by Dr. Sameer himself. And most of them show good effects both for treatment as well as for prevention, although the evidence base for prevention is less voluminous than for treatment. I'm just going to focus on some practical prescribing considerations with metformin. So you need to give it for 12 to 16 weeks. That's the duration most of the trials are there. And perhaps you need to give it at this duration to really appreciate the benefits, therapeutic benefits of metformin. The common side effects are nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and abdominal discomfort. Side effects rarely encountered would include headaches, myalgia, weakness, low vitamin B12 levels. And metformin also has a rare association with hypoglycemia, especially in people with diabetes who are also taking concurrent hypoglycemic agents. Practical prescribing considerations. How do you titrate metformin? So begin 500 milligram every morning for 1 week and then increase to 500 milligram twice daily for 1 week. So at the end of 2 weeks, you are on 1000 milligram per day. Subsequently, you want to increase by 500 milligram every week as tolerated till a target or maximum dose of 2000 milligram per day dosed as 1000 milligram BD. If gastrointestinal symptoms emerge during this up-titration process, you can very well hold the titration till the side effect subsides. You can even stop it and restart at the last tolerated dose. So most of the trials which have shown considerable effects with metformin have utilized a mean dose of about 1,500 to 2,000 milligrams, but you could aim for anywhere between 1,000 to 2,000. You need to monitor some parameters when patients are on metformin. The renal parameters, you need to monitor at least annually or even at biannual intervals if the eGFR is less than 60. You need to monitor liver function tests annually. You need to assess alcohol use regularly. Ask them to stay off alcohol because there's an increased risk of lactic acidosis if metformin is consumed along with alcohol. And also you need to consider vitamin B12 estimation annually, especially in anemia. Topiramate also has good evidence going for it. In fact, in this systematic review and network meta-analysis, so network meta-analysis where so many agents are compared head-to-head, topiramate is found to be more effective than metformin. So some of the important side effects, common side effects are paresthesia, sedation, dizziness, and memory difficulties. Rarer side effects include nephrolithiasis, secondary angle closure glaucoma, metabolic acidosis, and also a rare association with hyperammonemia. Prescribing considerations, you need to begin topiramate at 25 milligram nightly at bedtime for week one and then increase to 50 milligram nightly at week two. So at the end of 2 weeks, you are on 50 milligrams. Subsequently increase by 50 milligram twice daily for week three and then 50 milligram every week till you want to reach that maximum dose of 100 milligram twice daily. So at the end of, you'll take up anywhere between 4 to 5 weeks to reach this dose. You need to increase or decrease by 25 milligram if tolerability problems emerge anytime during this process. You can monitor the eGFR, LFT, and the serum bicarbonate levels every 3 months after starting therapy, and then initially 3 months after starting therapy, and then subsequently every 6 months. If metabolic acidosis is noted, you may want to reduce the topiramate dose because that's one of the risks with topiramate. And if there's a renal impairment, as a blanket rule, you can aim for a 50% target dose, then you would go for, if it is, so maybe around 50 milligram would be a reasonable dose in renal impaired individuals. And concomitant valproate with topiramate is not recommended because it really increases the risk for hyperammonemia. You might be wondering about sibutramine. So sibutramine is quite an effective agent. In fact, in the systematic review and network meta-analysis, sibutramine was the highest rank effectiveness agent. But as you, many of you may know, sibutramine is associated with a lot of cardiovascular risks, and it's been withdrawn in many countries, including India. So sibutramine is currently not recommended, not because of lack of efficacy, but because of tolerability issues. Coming to aripiprazole, aripiprazole has evidence in for antipsychotic-induced weight gain, especially in clozapine or olanzapine-induced weight gain. So there was this meta-analysis in 2014 of three trials, which found a mean difference in weight reduction versus placebo of 2.2 kilos approximately. So you may want to begin aripiprazole 5 milligram nightly and then increase to a target dose of around 15 milligram nightly. Two emerging agents, liraglutide, it's a glucagon-like peptide 1 agonist, which received FDA approval for management of antipsychotic-induced weight gain in 2014. There was this trial in the JAMA Psychiatry that it was a 16-week trial in which quite appreciable weight loss compared to placebo was noted with liraglutide. And since it has very minimal side effects, you know, the common side effects are only nausea, abdominal discomfort, and diarrhea, which is time-limited. And rarer side effects like hypoglycemia, pancreatitis, cholelithiasis, and cholecystitis. It might supplant some of the agents that we have now later. The only limiting factor is the cost. So I checked in IndiaMART, one cost of liraglutide for one injection is around 4,000 rupees. So that might be a limiting factor in its use. And finally, an emerging agent, samidorphan. So it has, in the last year, in the American Journal of Psychiatry, there was one trial published on this investigational opioid antagonist agent. So it was found to reduce olanzapine-induced weight gain. Side effects of the olanzapine-samidorphan combination in this trial was very similar to the olanzapine-placebo group. It was mainly sedation, somnolence, dizziness, and constipation. So not too different from placebo group. And these are all agents with insufficient evidence. So there are a lot of agents which have been trialed. So what I discussed was what had maximum evidence. So all these agents do not really have sufficient evidence for antipsychotic-induced weight gain. So these are not currently recommended, Olestat, L-carnitine, and all this in this list. So the last couple of slides are on management of other causes of weight gain in psychiatry. So atypical depression, I think Dr. Sameer also hinted in his presentation that atypical depression is one of the causes for weight gain. And it's associated with weight gain for long after the diagnosis has been made. So that's a concern with atypical depression. No specific trials for have been found for weight management specifically in atypical depression. So whatever general principles we discussed in terms of dietary modification, health promoting advice can be followed here too. And I think the bottom line here is to manage depression pretty well, because then perhaps you can also put a tab on the weight. And finally, sleep deprivation can also induce weight gain. So here the management would, rightly focus on advising proper sleep hygiene measures. And you might want to do a sleep study to rule out conditions like OSAS if the problem persists. And just as in other conditions, dietary advice and caloric reorganization of the diet should be a top priority. Apart from maybe, if all this fails and the non-pharmacological management also fails, then maybe you can consider pharmacological treatment. So to conclude, patients with SMI on antipsychotics should be assessed at an increasing frequency for weight gain as well as other metabolic parameters in the first year of institution of the treatment or observation, and then later quarterly. The three agents which have shown considerable efficacy, and that's all I want you to take home from this presentation, just three agents, metformin, topiramate, and adjunctive aripiprazole for clozapine and olanzapine-induced weight gain have shown efficacy. And regarding lifestyle interventions, which are positioned before pharmacological interventions, you perhaps clinicians need to focus on nutritional psychoeducation, dietary and physical activity modification, behavioral self-management, and motivational enhancement to promote the clients towards behavioral change and weight loss. These are some of my references. I acknowledge the inputs given by Dr. Shahul Amin, a consultant psychiatrist in St. Thomas Hospital, Kerala, and probably better known to all of you as the editor of Indian Journal of Psychological Medicine. I thank you for a patient listening. Over to the moderator.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas Menon, for an excellent presentation of management of obesity in psychiatry. So Dr. Sameer has covered the predictors, the what is how he focused on prevention is better than cure, and the various assessment, how the assessment should be done for psychiatric patients on the scale of obesity, as well as he has focused more on the, apart from healthy lifestyle modification, motivational enhancement therapy, are also focused on medications which can be used to treat obesity in patients in psychiatric patients. So there are a few questions in the question and answer box. I would like to open the questions now. So there is probably the question, the first question is probably more relevant to Dr. Sameer. So Dr. Sameer would be right person to answer this. It says, is weight gain more in people who are already obese compared to people who are not? So probably talking about pre-morbid obesity. Dr. Sameer, please.
Yes. Like I said, this has specifically been looked for lithium. So they had found actually that particular association. Yes, it is true. Probably it is true for all other. So anyone who is obese, already obese, are likely to gain more weight as compared to those who are not obese. But then also you need to understand that it also depends on other factors. Like let's say in childhood, adolescence, the weight gain would be much more as compared to someone who is obese but at a older individual. So females, they'll have more weight gain as compared to males. So these are some things also we need to keep in mind. So the earlier the exposure to psychotropic medications, the higher the chances for weight gain. So that also is there.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sameer. So there are two questions from Dr. Sachin from Delhi. He has one question about appetite suppressants, as well as there is one question he himself acknowledges that is out of context. He probably, this question is more relevant to Dr. Vikas Menon. He says that, what is the difference between serious mental illness and severe mental illness, since you have used it interchangeably? Dr. Vikas, please.
Yeah. What I have used SMI to denote severe mental illness. The severe mental illness, if I used serious mental illness, it was an inadvertent Freudian slip. So what I meant was severe mental illness, because that's the population where, you know, we are maximally concerned about weight gain. So severe mental illness is what I meant.
Appetite suppressants. And there is one more question by Dr. Sujoy Roy regarding Orlistat. Dr. Vikas?
Yes. So, as I said, there have been numerous trials with a lot of agents. So, specifically, what I would say, there are limited evidence for antipsychotic induced weight gain with these patients. You can go ahead, very well go ahead and use Orlistat. There are a few trials. What you have to remember when you're using Orlistat is you have to also concurrently advise them to go for a fat restricted diet. Yeah. Because otherwise, there is a problem that the drug won't get absorbed and there will be some fatty diarrhea in these patients. So that's another layer of complexity, basically, that you're building into the recommendations, because, you know, generally adherence is an issue. And when you also ask them to adhere to a low-fat diet, we don't know exactly whether the patients are actually adhering. So it's a layer of additional layer of complexity. So that's the problem with Orlistat. But otherwise, you can use it. But the evidence base for Orlistat is not as strong as metformin and topiramate. So that's why it's not recommended for antipsychotic induced weight gain. And was there anything else?
That's it about use of appetite suppressor in obesity.
Yeah. So I presume you may be referring to some stimulants and those kind of agents. So there have been a few trials with modafinil. There is one or two trials with modafinil for antipsychotic induced weight gain and some of the sympathomimetic agents. So again, there is a concurrent risk sometimes of these agents worsening some of the symptoms with severe mental illness itself. So overall, the evidence base is not very robust. And at the same time, you have some concerns about symptom worsening also. So maybe better to first try metformin and topiramate before you come to the other agents. So really, you know, it's a combination of life. One more principle is whichever agent you use, the effects are going to be pretty modest. So it's going to be about in the range of, you know, maximum I have seen is about 5 to 5.5 kilos of difference in the meta-analysis. I think Dr. Samir's paper, metformin was found to overall have a, you know, weighted mean difference of 5.17 kilos. So that was the thing there. If you go this side, I have some of the meta-analysis noted effects as low as 2.2. So whatever you do, whatever you give, it still means that the patients are going to remain overweight after your treatment. So it's always better to blend lifestyle interventions and pharmacologic interventions.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas Menon. Any other questions from the attendees, from the participants? If you could please type in the Q&A box. Questions are most welcome.
I just wanted to add one point to
please,
what Dr. Vikas said. Yeah, I would also concur with his conclusions that way. The other medications like appetite suppressants and other medications actually have a lot of side effects. So those are not, let's say, first line drug for, let's say, managing obesity in these patients. Metformin, I would also suggest as one of the safest medication. If you want to use pharmacotherapy, I think that would be the first one you should try, even before topiramate. Topiramate also has a lot of side effects. And as he rightly said, basically the weight loss is actually very modest for most of the patients. But then one thing that I want to highlight is it's not consistent actually. There's some patients, there can be really, really good weight loss with metformin. So I think, as we know, I mean, metformin doesn't have any major side effect. It's pretty well tolerated for most of my patients. I think that is one of the medications I use in my practice also, most common medication. And some patients actually have seen even weight loss up to even 10 kgs. So it's really good that way. So you should always give it a try before you try out other agents, which have more side effects.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Samir. There are a lot of other questions pouring in. Dr. Sachin has asked one more question. Lorcaserin and combination of topiramate and phenytramine use.
I think it's to me, but I have not heard of this lorcaserin molecule, but there is one trial on this topiramate and phenytramine combination. I found one trial in binge eating disorder. So it is a small 12-week trial. On binge eating disorder, the authors did note some positive benefits. But then again, we come to the point that evidence base is quite meager for these combinations. So why not try the most evidence base first, and then perhaps you could come to these agents. There's a lot of variability in individual response. And I think we are not yet at a point where we can really recommend, you know, what kind of patient profile matches with what kind of weight loss agent. So I think that's really a question where there's a lot of scope for future research. Even in individual trials, there have been some subgroup of patients who have responded quite robustly. I think that's what Dr. Samir also was hinting towards. So the challenge for us as clinicians is to find that subgroup which might respond more robustly to the weight loss medication.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas. There are other questions from Dr. Jagdisha Tirthahalli. Are there any trials of starting metformin with olanzapine to prevent weight gain?
Yes, sir. There is. There is trials for metformin for to prevention of weight gain. Overall, the body of evidence for prevention of weight gain, I would say, is less voluminous compared to treatment of weight gain. But there is a body of evidence, not only with metformin, but for topiramate also. In fact, one of the network meta-analysis found that topiramate outperforms metformin in terms of preventing weight gain. So there's also some kind of variability there, but there are trials and it could be used.
Thank you. There are questions about SSRIs. Are there any difference between individual SSRIs, which one causes more increase in weight?
Yeah, I think I'll take up that question. So all SSRIs, except fluoxetine, are known to cause weight gain. The maximum risk will be with paroxetine. Highest risk is, it's almost similar to what you see with tricyclics, other tricyclics. So considerable weight gain you see with paroxetine. Whereas others, even escitalopram, sertraline, all these SSRIs are associated with weight gain given for a prolonged period. If you're using for a short period, probably you'll not notice weight gain. But if you're using it for longer period, so you'll definitely see weight gain with all SSRIs. But it is not as marked as paroxetine and not as marked as what you see with antipsychotics.
Okay.
Even with amitriptyline. I mean, probably those have slightly more weight gain. But you see, even with fluoxetine, although it is said that it is actually weight neutral, and actually it was initially thought that fluoxetine actually causes weight loss rather than weight gain. But subsequent studies, I think post-marketing studies have shown, I mean, long-term use, fluoxetine also has also been associated with some weight gain. Obviously, not as marked as other SSRIs.
Okay.
So, and another one, citalopram. Specifically, citalopram also, I think that would be ranked next to paroxetine probably. We use escitalopram, but I think the studies are more with citalopram. This is another molecule which is associated with weight gain.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sameer. I think I had one question about reboxetine. I have few studies quoting that reboxetine can cause weight loss. Dr. Sameer.
Yes, I mean, again, there are two things. One is, yes, we have some evidence, very few studies. The other thing is reboxetine is out of market now. We don't have reboxetine. So probably we stopped using it for quite some time now, because once it was, I don't know why it disappeared from market also. I don't know what are the reason. But yes, there was some initial evidence, but then we didn't get a chance to use it. Didn't get a chance to study it properly, I suppose.
All right, thank you. And there are questions about, you know, is it worth using a medicine to lose 5 kilos of weight considering cost and side effects in our people? By Dr. Mamta Shetty.
I think that is directed towards me. So, madam, actually, there are two considerations here. One is, as we pointed out, you know, it's the 5 kilo weight loss is like an average difference, but there might be some subgroups of patients who lose a lot of weight. Actually, we have found that in clinical practice also, there are some patients who tend to lose appreciable weight after you begin your intervention. So, it's not a given that it's always 5 kilos. So that's point number one. Point number two is, more than the actual difference in weight, you know, we need to focus on how much, as I said, there is that kind of a threshold that if you can get them to lose 5% of their baseline body weight through the interventions, then that will translate to a lot of reduction in cardiovascular risk. So this is something that's proven in a study. So I think that's the figure that maybe we should be aiming at. Yes, I do understand your concerns. So how much worth is it to spend money? So maybe that's also the reason why you should go for metformin, because orlistat is costly and you need to dose it at 120 milligram TDS, whereas metformin is much more cost effective that way. Another reason for another shot in the arm for metformin.
All right. There is a question about metformin, about its risk of hypoglycemia.
Okay. Sir, actually metformin does not directly stimulate insulin secretion. So the risk of hypoglycemia is pretty low unless there are certain caveats. Say, for example, the patient is taking other hypoglycemic agents, or if the patient is fasting, like say, for example, you know, there may be some religious reasons why people fast. So if you get a patient who is, we must inquire about these things. If they are indulging in strenuous physical activity. So these are probably some considerations where you might be concerned about metformin-induced hypoglycemia. But otherwise, by and large, metformin is pretty safe to use. There is no concern with hypoglycemia. It's a rarely encountered side effect.
Next question is probably for Dr. Sameer Kumar. It focuses on, in case of obesity, should we always look for metabolic syndrome? Does obesity be present in usually for a long period of time? Dr. Sameer.
Yes, of course. I didn't go much into metabolic syndrome per se. Of course, when you have one component, you should look for all other components. And all those mechanisms, even common pathophysiology, whatever I discussed, holds true for metabolic syndrome as well. And we all know, I mean, it was just a component that we are discussing. But yes, of course.
Okay.
Yeah.
Which SSRI?
I just want to add one more point about that metformin that you discussed. A very rare chance of actually someone getting hypoglycemia with metformin. So after using in so many patients, we hardly see anyone actually developing. So whatever like Dr. Bikas mentioned, so barring those specific situations, you will actually not see hypoglycemia episodes with metformin. It is very safe. And I think someone asked about the dose, I think you already covered. So around 1 gram should be given. So that is the minimum dose I would suggest.
All right, great, thank you. There's a question regarding which SSRI should be started in a patient who is obese, depressed patient. Dr. Vikas?
Which
SSRI to be started in an obese, depressed patient?
So I think one of the consideration here that we have to think about is people, when they have obesity, they're likely to have a lot of comorbidities in terms of diabetes, hypertension. So they may be on a lot of concurrent medications. So if you really start some agent like, say, for example, fluoxetine or fluoxamine, then, you know, you're going to expose the patient to a lot of drug interactions. So there may be a safe choice there, maybe sertraline or citalopram, escitalopram. Maybe a safer choice in terms of their side, drug interaction profile and side effect profile.
All right. There is one more related question.
Okay. I will add to what Dr. Vikas said. Yes, the first choice would be sertraline and escitalopram, definitely. But you can also consider bupropion. If you think it is, although, I mean, I understand, I mean, many would hesitate to start bupropion as a first-line drug in depression. But this is one medication which is actually known to cause weight loss. So actually, there are studies which have shown weight reduction with bupropion. And actually, it is coming up as a naltrexone bupropion combination for obesity. So that is another one that you can think of.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Samir. There's a related question regarding SSRIs. What are there any specific management strategies for SSRI-induced weight gain? Is it similar or is it something different?
Dr. Samir, want to answer?
Yeah. So the management strategies, because we don't have a lot of literature, most of the literature is basically on antipsychotic-induced weight gain as such. But if you see, there are many mechanisms which are overlapping with antipsychotic-induced weight gain. So I presume the same medications will be helpful. Like I had tried using metformin in other weight gain, for example, lithium-induced weight gain, and I found it to be equally effective. So most likely the answer would be same. If you want to give a medication for weight gain, metformin would be one choice.
Okay.
Yes. We'll have to think about the inciting agent, whether you can shift over to a safer drug. Fluoxetine or something would be better.
Okay. Just to add on to that, sir, if I may.
Sure, Dr. Vikas.
Just to add on to that, I think while during my literature search for this talk, I also came across some trials on topiramate and metformin also for SSRI-induced weight gain specifically. And I think as far back as 2001 also, there were some trials on metformin and topiramate. So these agents, you know, they have a kind of a, they can be used in SSRI-induced weight gain, antipsychotic-induced weight gain, mood stabilizer-induced weight gain. And maybe, you know, as Dr. Samir said, if you really think that the patient needs to go for antidepressant, then you feel that SSRI is really making them gain weight, you may want to consider bupropion there because it's a little more weight neutral antidepressant. So these are probably some strategies that you can consider. So you could consider metformin, topiramate, and maybe an intelligent shift of antidepressant apart from all the other exercise, CBT, and other management that we discussed.
All right, thank you. I think we are running out of time. I would take this probably last question by Dr. Sujoy Rai. The question basically is about lithium. Does lithium cause weight gain as such, or is it it causes hypothyroidism, later it causes weight gain? What is the mechanism of weight gain in lithium?
If you ask the mechanism, probably I would say we don't know. So there could be multiple mechanisms, like for other, let's say antipsychotics, antidepressants, we have more studies actually. Lithium that way has been understudied, specifically lithium-induced weight gain. So there's not a lot of literature available on that. So probably multiple mechanisms, but then, like I said, medications which are used for other conditions, other weight gain, like metformin, topiramate, will actually help in lithium-induced weight gain as well. But again, I would say, rather than going for topiramate, which has more side effects, you should try metformin first.
Metformin from Dr. Sameer. Yes, to go to Dr. Vijay for conclusion.
I must thank all the panelists, mainly Dr. Sameer Kumar Paraj and Dr. Vikas Menon for their wonderful presentation. I think they have done a lot of homework and come and definitely wanted to give the best, their best at this one. So I must thank for their hard work and also taking time off to have come here and delivered such a nice presentation, very useful, especially clinicians. I'm sure people will join me in thanking you, because a lot of clinicians, I have not used metformin, but it's a take-home message for me. If I see a lot of people having, my patients having severe weight gain with antipsychotics, psychotropics rather, metformin is a choice. In fact, this is something I had heard in UK also mentioning. Metformin is a safe drug, such a safe drug that you can even put in the drinking water. Somebody was mentioning such a safe drug. And it is also used in, as you know, in PCOD as well. It was a very useful, interesting talk. Thank you very much again, Dr. Menon and Dr. Praraj. Thank you very much. Thanks, Dr. Arvind. You ran it so well, succinctly, asking relevant questions, keeping the questions very small and very simple, running the show very well. Mr. Ganeshan, thank you very much. Without you, we couldn't have done this wonderful show.
Sir, thank you very much. And pleasure and duty, both.
Thanks for ongoing support. We will need your support ongoing for a long time.
Always there, sir. Always.
Definitely. Thank you very much, micro team. Thank you very much. Thanks, Mahesh. Thanks for supporting.
Thanks, Vijay, for anchoring. And thanks, everybody, for this wonderful evening. Pleasure listening to all of you.
And must thank all the participants. Because of the participants, we are able to run this. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, we take leave.
Thank you. Good night. Have a great weekend. Night. Bye.
Yeah. Good night. Shubhratri, everyone. Good night. Thank you.